Sí al empleo, al desarrollo económico, a la sostenibilidad, a las energías alternativas, a las experiencias internacionales. La Mancomunidad del Sureste de Gran Canaria organiza el Seminario Internacional de Comarcas Sostenibles 2017. Días 4 y 5 de abril, Centro Cívico del Carrizal Ingenio. Asistencia libre y gratuita. Más información en seminariocomarcasostenibles.com. Sureste Sostenible. Agüimes, Ingenio y Santa Lucía.
Les voy a presentar ahora a Carlo Rondinini de la Universidad de Roma, en Italia. Carlos es otra eminencia a nivel internacional. Es el coordinador del programa global Mammal Assessment y su interés por la investigación es la conservación de mamíferos a nivel mundial, incluyendo la distribución, el hábitat, el riesgo de extinción y el establecimiento de prioridades de conservación. La investigación actual de su equipo se centra en la distribución de hábitats terrestres para mamíferos y el desarrollo de métodos cuantitativos y medidas para la evaluación del riesgo de extinción de mamíferos utilizando la lista roja de la UICN, así como el performance de indicadores de tendencias de la biodiversidad. El modelado de escenarios bajo la cubierta terrestre y el cambio climático son la base analítica de gran parte de su esfuerzo de investigación actual. Carlos, bienvenido al sureste de Gran Canaria, tienes la palabra.
Bueno, buenas tardes a todos. Yo soy de Roma, en Italia. Entiendo un poquito de español, pero no hablo bastante para una ponencia de 45 minutos. Así hablaré en inglés. My presentation today is about changes, expected changes, and observed changes in biodiversity under global change. Why biodiversity? Well, that's an interesting point. We have heard a lot of really interesting and entertaining presentations on sustainability, but what is sustainability in the end? Sustainability is defined as a way of not harming the environment, of keeping the environment safe and preserve it for the future generations. So what we will see now today is what we are doing to the environment, what we are expected to do to the environment under various scenarios in the future. And it's a nice parallel with the conference yesterday about the oceans, because I will talk about terrestrial biodiversity. This graph represents the growth of human population in the last 8,000 years. You can see that human population has never, ever been above 500 million people until very few hundred years ago. 500 million people over the entire Earth means that, well, people could enjoy the Earth. They could do whatever they wanted, basically, with the Earth. They were not enough to do real harm to the Earth for most of the time. And even then, you will see that some dramatic changes already started to happen. Even 8,000 years ago, 7,000 years ago, even before then, people started to bring some of the larger species, the larger mammals, to extinctions. The mammoth, for example, was one of the first extinctions that was due to hunting, to excessive hunting, over-exploitation of species. But what you see from the Industrial Revolution, basically, is an incredible explosion of the human population. This curve, if you wanted to fit a curve to this growth, it would be exponential. That's exponential. And I was born 45 years ago. When I was born, the population in the world was half the size of the population now. This makes an enormous pressure on the environment. It makes an enormous pressure on whatever else is not human. And this is why the era where we live is called the Anthropocene. Interestingly, I've seen exactly the same picture in yesterday's talk about the oceans, and actually, this is Malé, the capital of Maldives, a place that one could think is a nice wild place where to relax. It's completely covered by buildings. And this is what's happening at a different scale in many, many other places of the world. So we're simply taking out space for nature. We are taking all the space for ourselves. This is urbanization, which is, of course, a big, potentially a very big problem. But the biggest problem is not the space that we use for buildings. It's the space that we use for feeding ourselves. It's the space that we use for agriculture. And indeed, I will talk about this a bit later on, the speed at which we are converting the natural environments to feed ourselves, to feed a never-ending growing population, is the main threat to biodiversity at the moment, even more than climate change right now. This map represents the global human footprint and how it has changed between 1993 and 2008. You can see the footprint up in the top panel and the change in the bottom panel. You see that even in this small, very small time lapse, footprint has increased in many parts of the world. The human footprint has increased, and it has increased especially in the tropical belts, which is where most of biodiversity is. So you can expect that this has had an effect on biodiversity. Very interestingly, a long time ago, this is from 1991, it's a graph from a classic paper on science by Michael Soule. Michael Soule is the man who, together with John Gilpin, invented the discipline of conservation biology by publishing a very influential book that opened the field for an entire new generation of scientists working on the effects of human pressures on biodiversity. It's a very simple prediction that he made. If human population grows so dramatically, the other species have to go down, because there is not much space left for the other species. This is what we see. These are from two publications, one in Science a few years ago and the other one more recent. And actually, as you can expect, the predictions made by Michael Soule are sadly true. These graphs represent the red list index. I will not go into the technical details of the red list index, but basically the red list index is a measure of the collective movement of a group of species towards extinction or away from extinction. And you see that for amphibians, mammals, birds, even more dramatically for corals, the recent trend, the graph is here from 1980 for amphibians and from 1990 and beyond for the other groups. The recent trends are species moving towards extinction. And the graph on the right is just focused on a subset of large mammals, but it extends on a longer time step. And it shows that this decline was already ongoing from 1975. And that's sadly expected. And this is the situation. That's the most complete picture of the current situation, but it's not the most updated. It's from the same 2010 paper. And very briefly, in this figure you see all groups of animals and plants that have been assessed so far. Amphibians, cartilaginous fish, mammals, reptiles, bony fish, birds, and then invertebrates, and then plants. And the green bars represent the proportion of species that are not currently threatened with extinction. The gray bars represent the proportion of species for which we know nothing about extinction risk. And yellow, orange, and red represent species for which we know that they are at imminent risk of extinction. They're going, they're risking extinction in the very near future. So overall, this picture tells us that about one quarter of the species that have been assessed so far, which are a large sample, there are millions of species on the Earth, and then we could never assess them all. But this large sample is quite representative of the species, and one quarter of the species are threatened with extinction right now due to that increase of human population, basically, which is the ultimate driver for all these changes. Then the proximate drivers are more than one. We know them very well now. One, the most important, as I said, is conversion of natural environments, but climate change is an important, another important driver. And invasive species, I will not discuss invasive species in particular in this talk, because we are not projecting yet invasive species into the future, although we will probably have results in the next 2 to 3 years. But invasive species are particularly important in places like islands, and the Canaries make no exception in this respect. The Canaries have mostly, at least for mammals, and not for birds, but they have quite a large number of alien birds. So they have mammals and birds and many other species that are not native of the islands. The species that are not native can be extremely harmful for the environment. You also have some of the, very incredibly for relatively small islands, you also have some mammal endemics, which is, you have a lot of insect endemics, that's normal. But mammal endemics is not so normal. You have the canary shrew, which is a small insectivore, mouse-like. It's only found in the Canary Islands. And you have a bat, the Plecotus tenerife, that is endemic to the Canaries as well. So you still have some very important species to conserve, but as all islands in the world, you have a lot of invasive species, and that's one of the main problems that have caused extinctions on the islands in the past. This is a slightly updated account for mammals. This is just the flyer of symposium where we presented the results of the last assessment of mammals at the last Congress of the International Union for the Conservation of Nature. And basically the key message is that the proportion of mammals at risk of extinction has increased since the previous assessment, which was done in 2008. So rather than 25%, now it's almost 28% and counting. The situation is has never improved over the last 20 or 30 years. And also this result is from what we presented there. Just to give you numbers, out of 50% of the mammals that we had reassessed at the time, we found 80 species that were going towards extinction. They were in a higher category of extinction risk, and just 8 species that were improving. And the species that you see there are very iconic species that made nice stories in the press. Orangutan. Now, all orangutan species of orangutans, of gorillas, of chimpanzees, bonobos, all the great apes are now critically endangered, which is the category of the highest category of endangerment. They are one step away from extinction. Extremely small, fragmented populations that are declining very, very quickly. We are the only great ape that is not critically endangered. That's something that we should really think about. The other story is actually a story of conservation success, and that's the panda is now less threatened. It's still in a threat category. It's vulnerable, which is the yellow bar that you saw in the previous slide. The red the pandas were endangered 8 years ago, and moved one step away from extinction because of intensive conservation action by the Chinese. I've told you that land conversion is the most imminent and important threat to biodiversity. But climate change is also an important threat. This slide is from a recent analysis that we did for birds and mammals. And actually, while by looking at the published information, the published synthesis that we have on biodiversity, one can have a sense that not so many species are threatened with extinction. We analyzed all existing evidence published in the scientific literature about threats of extinction, and we realized that possibly 50% of the species of mammals are actually already under pressure and are already declining because of climate change. And 25% of birds are in the same condition. So climate change is already impacting species more than we previously thought. And it's not only impacting species, this is another synthesis that we made last year, not just on species, but on all aspects of biodiversity, from the genetic level all the way to the population and community and ecosystem level. And most processes related to biodiversity already show here or there in the world signs of impact. So the impact of climate change is already very, very pervasive. So what do projections tell us? These are projections, not scenarios. The main difference is that projections are just if business as usual, what's happened in the past will continue in the near future, what will happen. And of course, the picture cannot be different from what you see here. This is an analysis that we did in 2014 for the 2020 targets, the Aichi target. The Convention on Biological Diversity, which is an important international convention that has been signed by almost the vast majority of countries in the world, has set ambitious targets for biodiversity conservation that are called the Aichi targets. And at some point, they asked to a group of people to tell how the countries were doing in terms of achieving the targets or going away from the targets. And that's a synthesis, broad synthesis of the results. You see in the different panels, you see in the first row an example of two indicators. We summarized many, many indicators, but this is just a few examples. Two indicators of pressures, anthropogenic pressures on the biodiversity. On the second panel from top, there are indicators of biodiversity itself, what's happening to biodiversity. The third row represents trends in ecosystem services, nature contributions to people in the most recent language, which is less understandable to me than ecosystem services, but anyway, that's what has been decided. And the fourth row represents conservation action. So in synthesis, what do these things tell us? They tell us that anthropogenic pressures keep increasing, and that's what you can expect, because of course the human population keeps increasing. So how pressures can be declining? Well, we'll see a possible answer in the next slides. But anyway, pressures are increasing, and biodiversity is declining in response. And ecosystem services, that is, all the services that we get from nature for free, including pollination, including food, including regulation, including cleaning of water and air and so on, they're going down. Even if conservation action is stepping up, conservation has stepped up. There is more investment in conservation now than ever, but it cannot be enough, or it's not certainly enough, considering the increase of human population and the pattern of consumption that we keep following. So what are the scenarios for the future? Well, we have under the business as usual, that is the previous trend will continue in the future. We know that the human population will hit almost 10 billion people in 2050. We will keep losing forests. We will keep losing natural habitats in general, but tropical forests are probably the most biodiverse habitats. And we will lose another almost 300 million hectares, which is more or less the size of India, and an amount of tropical forest that is the size of India. That would be a big blow to the remaining tropical forests. Temperature will increase by probably more than 2 degrees. There is a lot of variability in the projections, but certainly will keep increasing. So what will happen to biodiversity in this situation? What will happen to biodiversity depends on species a little bit. It depends on the response of species to pressure. Some species may be more adaptable than others, may cope better with changes than others, may find themselves in a better condition to cope with changes. Those on islands will have less ways of escaping changes. Those on mainland may have more chances to survive. But very importantly, the scenarios depend on our changes, because we are in the Anthropocene. So we are in the era of human domination on the Earth. So what we do has important outcomes on biodiversity. Let's look at species first. What can species do while the world is burning? Burning in terms of climate, but also in terms of destruction of natural habitats. They can cope with change. Many species do, actually. Many species are relatively generalist. Many species do better with humans than without. All the synanthropic species that live in cities do better with humans, actually. Rats will thrive with increasing human population. So resilience. Species may adapt, but the time for adaptation is really, really, really small. In evolutionary time, species have very little time to adapt. There will be some room for adaptation and evolution of species towards the new conditions, but I wouldn't count on it very much. They can go extinct, locally extinct or globally extinct. They can try to move. So we try to figure out a little bit which species can do what, basically. And let's focus first on the first three possibilities: resilience, adaptation, extinction. Coping with changes, or evolving, or going extinct. So this is another recent analysis that tells us what we can expect from these different groups, orders in taxonomic terms, orders of mammals under climate change. How we did the analysis, we observed the responses, that we used the observed responses to change, and we related them to some characteristics of the species, like the breadth of their diet, their capability of dispersing to different new environments, and so on. And the result is that some groups of species wouldn't do horribly bad. For example, for carnivores, we expect a higher proportion of species. You see on the right here, 57% of the species that would respond positively to climate change, and 30% of the species that would respond negatively, and other species would not respond, or we don't know. And rodents also, not all of them, but a certain proportion of them would respond reasonably well. But for many other species, changes are going to be certainly negative, and these species include marsupials, and especially marsupial carnivores, kangaroos, koalas, and wombats in Australia, primates, elephants. For all these species, you see that we expect a negative response for 100% of them, all of them. So that would be a big, big change and a big, big reduction for these species. That's the result for birds, based on similar reasonings. And we expect tolerant responses to climate change from water birds, while we expect very bad responses from doves, pigeons, parrots, seabirds, would all do very bad. And this map represents the areas where we expect species to be more hit by changing climate, depending on the amount of expected change from now and 2050, and what are the characteristics of the species that live in a certain area. And as you see, all of Australia and most of Africa are red. We expect the highest risk of climate in this place for mammoths, at least. Now, let's stay with species responses to change. And let's look at which species are more likely to escape climate change. This is a bit of analysis that we did for the last IPCC report on terrestrial and inland water systems. And the result is basically summarizing this picture that looks pretty complex, but in the graph on the top left, you see different possible trajectories of climate change. And we keep the red one, which is the one that would bring to this 4 to 6 increasing climate to 2100, as the most likely under the current trend. So assuming no societal change. And it's compared with the speed at which species can move, at the speed at which species can disperse, which is the top right graph. And the result is in the bottom right graph. And the result tells us that for most of the species, this analysis also includes trees and other plants, for most of the species, the speed of climate change would be too high to escape. And only some of the groups, some of the more mobile carnivores and some of the more mobile ungulates, for example, but also for butterflies, some of the butterflies, we can expect that they could just try to find a suitable climatic space somewhere else if there are no barriers to dispersal and if all goes well for this species. This doesn't mean that it will really happen. That's the most optimistic scenario for this species. Okay, so far in terms of species responses to change. But the most important bit for us, because it's interesting for us to understand which species are more likely to respond negatively or positively to change, because we can do conservation action on the species that are unlikely to make it if they are not helped with conservation actions. But on the other hand, the most important thing for us is to know what we can do to make things change in the future, to change these pathways from business as usual to something else. So first of all, let me show you a couple of examples that show that changes, either in policy or social changes, make a difference on biodiversity. Here, you see, on the top row, you see the red list index for large carnivores in South America. And you see how this red list index has changed between 1970 and basically 1996, which is the period when the CITES went into use. So the Convention on International Trade in Endangered Species. Basically, this was a big blow for the commerce of large carnivores from South America. And you can see that the red list index goes up. This means that, and that's the red list index for carnivores in South America. This means that these species moved away from extinction when the ban of trade was in place. In the bottom row, you see something that is not deliberate policy, but it's a social change. That is the collapse of the Soviet Union. And that's the red list index for the large mammals during the collapse of the Soviet Union. And you see that the trajectory of species of the red list index goes down. Species moved toward extinction in the area. And the reason is that after the collapse of the Soviet Union, there have been years of basically anarchy, loss of central power, in which people did whatever they could. and whatever they could was basically cutting as much as forest as they could, because they could sell the wood and make money out of it, make a live out of it. This collapse corresponded to a collapse for biodiversity. That's an important story for us. So now that we know that changes in policies and changes in society do affect biodiversity, and we know that we can record these changes using some indicators, right, like the Red List Index, we know that we can test policies for the future. What could be the effects of future policies on biodiversity or future different socioeconomic pathways? Well, that's one of the main research lines in my lab, and we do it using scenarios of direct drivers, that is, scenarios of climate change, scenarios of change in land cover that depend on how societies will develop. And these scenarios are developed by different groups. So far, we used the Globio scenarios from PBL in the Netherlands, which is the Netherlands Institute for Environment, Minister of Environment, basically, and other scenarios developed by collaborators at the University of Potsdam to explore different things. But what we do, basically, in a nutshell, we start from the current distribution of a species. You see here a mock distribution of a species in southern Italy. We project the potential change in this distribution based on changes in climate, based on climate scenarios, and we project the expected suitable habitat within the projected range for the species. So we move the boundaries of the area where the species are found, and we move the habitat of the species within these boundaries. So we have projections of where the species could go in the future, and we use their capability of dispersing to limit these movements. And based on this, we do a series of different analyses. I will show you three analyses. The first one is the comparison of four scenarios. These four scenarios were developed for the Millennium Ecosystem Assessment and were translated into scenarios of land cover change by this GloBio project. And these scenarios foresee different worlds in 2050. In all these worlds, population grows from the current size. Two scenarios are globalized, two scenarios are regionalized, two are proactive in terms of environmental policies, two are reactive in terms of environmental policies. So there are different realizations of future worlds that were designed by the group of people that participated to the Millennium Ecosystem Assessment. What would these scenarios mean for mammals? Because this is what we mostly work with in this scenario analysis. Well, these maps show that all scenarios would be either good or bad for a certain number of species. For example, you see that across all scenarios, the United States would lose habitat for a large number of species, as well as Southern Africa would lose habitat for all these species, for a lot of mammal species, under all possible scenarios. But of course, the scenarios can be different. So in the bottom figure, you see which changes, which places are affected the most in at least one scenario. And you can see the difference between these two maps. So for some countries, changes all go in the same direction, whatever the scenario is. For other countries, scenarios do make a difference. And if different countries decided to choose different pathways, this would have different outcomes for biodiversity. But we went a little more in detail with our analysis, and we compared two scenarios in particular. That's a newer family of scenarios that were developed for the RioPlus20 conference. RioPlus20 was a conference that was held 20 years after the 1992 conference in Rio, which founded the Convention on Biological Diversity. These two scenarios that we analyzed are a business as usual scenario, so no change in policies, a continuing expansion of agriculture, fisheries, and aquaculture, an increased use of fossil energy, and this is associated with a certain climate scenario that was developed by IPCC. And we compared it with a consumption change scenario that was designed to achieve multiple sustainable development goals. And this consumption change scenario is interesting because it achieves these SDGs. It reduces the consumption of meat to 25% of the current level, which on average on the world, which could sound very small amount. In reality, this 25% is still twice the amount that is considered healthy by the World Health Organization. So it's not the world becoming vegetarian. It's the world eating still too much meat, but a bit less meat than now. And also halving waste, using a lot of reduced impact logging rather than clear cuts. And this is associated with another climate scenario. You see the difference for mammals in Europe is stunning. If you look at the scenario, the three lines at the top, they show what would happen to habitat availability to mammals in 2050 under the consumption change scenario, and different assumptions because we don't know how mammals will behave. So those lines represent the uncertainty in the behavior of mammals in response to change. But anyway, they are all on the top. The red lines represent what we expect under the business as usual scenario. And you can see that on average, just changing consumption patterns would almost halt the loss of mammal habitat in Europe by 2050 versus a decrease of 15 to 20 or more than 20%. If we scale this up globally, this is the Red List Index again, projected for all mammals globally. And the colors are the same colors as before, so you see the difference between consumption change and business as usual. The three graphs represent our three different assumptions on what mammals will do, so they represent uncertainty. But whatever the uncertainty in the response of species, we always see a clear, evident difference between business as usual and a change in consumption patterns. So we clearly see that policy, even in the absence of further conservation action, different ways of living could make an enormous difference for biodiversity. The last analysis I will present you is an analysis that we are still running. It's a very long time we're doing it. And it's a comparison of two different ways of achieving the same level of climate mitigation. Both ways, in both scenarios, climate mitigation is very intense, and this keeps the trajectory of climate change to a small increase, which is better than the very large increase that is expected if we do nothing. And the two different ways are investing a lot in biofuel or stocking CO2 through afforestation, while still being both livable and for people, of course. They're not unrealistic scenarios in terms of socioeconomic development. And you see the difference here. I kept this picture. This picture is probably the reason why Fefi Caballero invited me to this conference, because I projected it at the COP21 in Paris, where we met. And this picture shows very well that mitigating climate by using biofuels would, in terms of change in biodiversity, which is again, in this case, change in availability of habitat for mammals, would be almost the same than as business as usual. So it would be no benefit for biodiversity whatsoever. While doing exactly the same thing through afforestation would bring an enormous benefit for biodiversity. It would change the trajectory of habitat availability for mammals. and this picture presents the same result to 2095, so extended another 50 years, and the result is even more dramatic in terms of loss of habitat for mammals under the biofuel scenario, which is the orange one. It's worse than the business as usual, and the afforestation scenario, which is the green one. So coming to a very quick conclusion. We know that the current level of conservation effort is insufficient to counteract anthropogenic pressures because the human population keeps growing. So conservation action alone is not enough. It has proven to be not enough, even if there has been progress. For example, protected areas have increased from a few percent in 1990 to almost 20% now, but it's not enough. We know that policies and social changes do shape our lives and will shape our future, for sure, whatever we do. But we know that we can test the effect of these policies with scenario analysis. So now we have a very powerful tool to see what the effect of policies will be. We can do it for biodiversity, but I'm sure that my colleagues can do it for many other things. So my message is just, let's choose our future and go for it. Thank you.